Using visual field and OCT reports, how to increase our confidence in the diagnosis of glaucoma? A visual field defect must be real. To be real, it must be confirmed on repeated exams. OCT does not directly measure tissues. It measures differences in light reflectivity of these tissues. In this example, signal strength is low, so if you accept such a low value, different layers will appear thinner than should be. So for each OCT machine, there is a minimal value to accept the reports. Keep in mind that OCT changes may occur in normal individuals. For example, in this study, false positive RNF changes were found in 1/4 of 150 normal healthy persons. As you can see, this is one of the results, while the field and the fundus pictures are normal. In another study for the ganglion cells, false positive was there in 132 normal persons. You get these ratios of false positive depending on which of these parameters, and this is the corresponding false positive ratio in that study. A third study showed that we may have false positive in retinal fiber layer in 30% of the cases, and for the ganglion cell complex in 40% of the cases. These are some of the examples of false results. That study showed that typical glaucoma damage are located in the temporal macular region and the respect the horizontal raphe, and there should be corresponding retinal fiber layer defect, and that the changes are most likely to be arcuate or crescent in shape. So to improve our performance, whenever you see a visual field or OCT printout, you need to check these three main points: asymmetry. Glaucoma is typically a bilateral disease, but frequently asymmetrical. Visual field and OCT defects are commonly asymmetric at the time of diagnosis. Differences can be found between superior and inferior parts, or between right and left eye. For example, the glaucoma hemifield test compare 5 zones up with similar zones below the horizontal level. Whenever at least one zone pair differs by amount found in fewer than 1% of the normal population, then you get outside normal limit sprint. If the difference is fewer than 3% but more than 1% of the normal subject, to get a borderline printout. Different machines of OCT also show differences. In this example here, differences between retinal fiber layer right and left, difference in the neural rim right and left, the neural rim right and left. Here in the OptiView, differences between the two eyes, and in the recent models, you have difference between the two eyes or between up and down. Again in the Topcon, differences between the two eyes, differences in the different parameters of the macular area. Heidelberg, again, differences between the eyes. Also, in the Heidelberg with the posterior segment photos, you can have differences between right and left. And between up and down or down. Second, you need to check areas constant with glaucoma. We are all acquainted of the field changes typical for glaucoma. But keep in mind that changes in the central part can occur in early stages of glaucoma or even in cases of glaucoma suspects. This was proved structurally and functionally. We may miss such changes if we do 24 field of vision, but if you go to the 10 degree field of vision, then the chance to get such changes are high. That's why a new software, the 24 of Humphrey, included central points commonly affected in early stages of glaucoma. In the OCT, you need to check superior and inferior quadrant, superior temporal, inferior temporal, and the average thickness of the retinal fiber layer. For the macula, ganglion cells, lesions that respect horizontal line, lesions that arcuate, lesions that are temporal to the fovea, all are pointing to the possibility of glaucoma. Lastly, you need to correlate changes inside the OCT print and also changes between OCT and visual field. For example, if you have changes in the ganglion cells of the macula going on with the changes around the disc, then we are more sure of our diagnosis. Combined print and the Zeiss machine show the ganglion cells and the macula together with the nerve fiber layer around the disc. And when they are going together, then we are sure of the diagnosis. To compare OCT with the field, back in 2000, Garway Health and his group traced visible nerve fiber bundles from optic nerve head to points of 24 visual field pattern. And they proposed this relationship between each part of the field and corresponding part in the optic nerve. This part will end here, this part will be there, and so on. And again, this relation shown here can be relocated on this graph. Another study showed the relation between changes in the central area depending on the field suggested by Garway, changes in the ganglion cell inner plexiform layer, and changes in the peripapillary nerve fiber layer. Such changes are now grouped in the printout of the Zeiss showing the same changes suggested by Garway. Now I want to show you some details about this model proposed by Hood and his group. This model, they make changes in three areas. First, central 8 degrees. Here they have the average of the retinal ganglion cell inner plexiform thickness layer in the macula from 128 control healthy persons. And here they show the thickness compared to the distance from the fovea. And the OCT results are shown here in red. And they compare the result with histological study shown here in this dotted line, and when they made adjustment for this dotted line because of the shrinkage that the authors show, then the black line is almost typical with that of the OCT. And they found that the thickest part is located 8 degrees around the fovea. When these authors studied the relation between the ganglion cell layer thickness and the visual field, they used a displacement model of the retinal ganglion cell bodies suggested by Drasdeau et al. The connected lines here is the amount of displacement So the actual location here, but this is the location of the receptors, but the ganglion cells for these receptors are located away because of the Henle's layer distributing the ganglion cells away from the central part. And they made such adjustment. This is the 10 degree visual field without the adjustment, and when they apply such adjustment, the locations are in such a way. So this is the 24 degree before any adjustment, and when they make the adjustment, these are the new locations. And as you notice here, the most dense part of the ganglion cells are located inside these four points, and the area of common damage of glaucoma is located inside these four points. That's why whenever you are doing a 24 degree test, you may miss changes because we ignore such a displacement factor. When they compare the location of the retinal ganglion cell thickness with the total deviation of the field of vision, data were grouped into five eccentric locations on these degrees, and they came out with these findings. A clear relationship between regions of visual field scotoma and corresponding region of the retinal ganglion cell was found. A considerably weaker relation was found outside 7.2 degree. Also, as we mentioned before, they found that the retinal ganglion cell inner plexiform layer thickness decreased markedly behind this region. Therefore, they considered the central 8 degrees for their module. Second, they suggested instead of doing the examination from temporal to superior to nasal to inferior to temporal, as we accustomed to, they changed it to start from the nasal. So, doing such a thing, we end by having the temporal area in the center of the print. And this is easy for us to visualize the relation between the macular retinal nerve fiber layer thinning and the visual field effect. Then they start to show a correlation between OCT deviation and visual field. They started by averaging the results of 128 control eyes. They measured the retinal ganglion cell inner plexiform layer. This is the average result of the whole group. And this is the retinal fiber layer around the disc. Then they start to compare changes in glaucomatous eyes. They have three groups of glaucomatous persons. First group, mean deviation is minimal. Second group, moderate field changes. Third group, high field changes. And this is the number on each group. And they compare them with the normal. And again, they measure the thickness around the disc and in the macular area. Green means there is no difference. Red means most thinning occurs. And as you notice here, there is a progressive thinning as the mean deviation increases in the field. Thinning affects the lower part more than the upper part. And also, thinning is more temporal to the fovea. They found this part to be commonly affected, and they suggested that the retinal ganglion cells project their fibers into this inferior quadrant. That's why it is crowded and it is affected more. They term this part the macula vulnerable zone. The remaining part of the ganglion cells here and in this uncrowded part of the disc. The remaining part of the field, 15 degrees and the nasal area, will project in the zone between 90 degrees and 45 degrees. Similarly, the upper part between 45 and 90. These are known as the inferior vulnerable zone and the superior vulnerable zone. The remaining part of the field up and down will end in the area between 90 and 35 up and down. So same can be shown here. The macula vulnerable zone is located here between 38 to 69 degrees. The inferior vulnerable zone between 45 and 90. The superior vulnerable zone here between 45 and 90. So this is one of my cases. I just capture the image, I make the change, and start to compare it with what is suggested by Hoots. Then you can find the exact location of expected damage. Lastly, the suggested anatomical relation between OCT and and this is the printout they have now. It's available in two machines, on the Topcon and the Heidelberg. Here you have the section to revise actually that the segmentation was correct. This is the thickness map of the retinal fiber layer. This is the deviation map. It is inverted to be like the things in the field. Then it is printed out here, and here you can see the dots. The small dots are those of the central 10 degrees, and the larger black dots are those of the 24 degrees. Again, here this is the ganglion cell inner plexiform layer, and the deviation of this part is plotted here against the field. So these are the field view of changes on the OCT. Here, another example, and this is the Heidelberg. Similarly, but here they are showing the thickness of the nerve fiber layer and of the ganglion cells, and they are shown here in relation to the 24 degrees and in relation to the 10 degrees. So to sum up, we can increase our confidence in results if we check for asymmetry, if we check for locations prone for glaucoma damage, and if we correlate the different parts of the OCT and also to correct OCT with the visual field. Thank you for your attention.